think. But nonetheless, really, one walks in here and the love, the energy, the camaraderie, the spiritedness, the warmth, the friendship, the honesty and candidness make this place very special. And as I was looking around the room, I thought to myself that at your age, which is pretty young, most of you have seen and heard almost everything. It used to be that you had to be 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90 to experience everything. You know, once you were 96 years old, you've seen it all, you've heard it all. But I look here at 20-year-olds, 21-year-olds, 22-year-olds, 23-year-olds, 24-year-olds, and 25-year-olds. And you have more or less seen almost everything.
Rabbi, you ain't seen shit.
I know that.
So, the 40-year-olds have to catch up.
Right, right.
I'm 40-year-old.
Now, I'm not now gonna be one of those romantic, delusional people who speak of the good old days, because the old days were not so good. They were good in some ways, they were horrible in other ways. But by being old, they're just different. But I do want to say that when I was your age, I wasn't naive, but I knew very little of what you know today. It was much more, I was more sheltered and living in a certain cocoon, which in many ways is really the reality of your generation. Generation that has been, not by choice, not by your own choice, but really by God's plan, chosen to see reality without any cover-ups, without any camouflaging, without any decorations, to see things in a very raw, naked, real, and authentic way. And somehow God felt that you're capable of picking up the broken pieces and turning them into masterful art. So I congratulate you, each one of you. There was a man named Hemingway, one of America's greatest writers. Hemingway wrote, "Life breaks all people, but some people know how to live in broken places better than others." Hemingway committed suicide. He did not know how to live in a broken place. But what his insight is very penetrating, namely, that life is challenging, and life affords us the ability to see lots of wholesome things and lots of broken things. And the greatness of a life is to be able to learn how, when Moshe Rabbeinu broke the luchas, God told him, "Thank you for breaking them." What was the thank you? The thank you was, "Thank you for teaching the Jewish people how to find light, not only in wholesome places, but also in broken places." To be able to break the luchas, which are sacred, into little pieces, and then realize that in those little pieces, there's a secret and a music all its own, is very unique. I was standing one night, on President Street between New York and Nostrand Avenue, on the porch of my brother Baruch's house in the middle of the block. And we were chatting, and a group of young boys, not so young, a little younger than you, were walking from the train station. They were walking from the train station on Nostrand down President. And I looked at them and he looked at them, and their demeanor, their countenance, the way they were presenting themselves verbally and in dress and garb was, even by today's standards, not completely defined, should I say, by the norms of the Crown Heights section of Brooklyn, even in 2014. My brother was a very warm young man, not so young, but yeah, I guess he's a young man. Some of you know him. Went over and hugged each of those boys. And then he came up to me and he says, "You know what I feel about them?" I said, "No, I don't know what you feel about them." And he said something very, very insightful. You may not know how insightful it is. You'll see why you may not know. But to me, it was extremely insightful. He said, "I'm going to explain to you something." And Rabbi Shemtev, I'm sure you'll be able to identify with this, Reb Moshe. Approximately the year 1991, when I assume most of you were thoughts in the Creator's primordial mind, the Rebbe, the Lubavitcher Rebbe, said then that the time of redemption has arrived. Famously. And he even said you can touch it and feel it. And he even said if you open your eyes, you'll mamish feel it and see it. So my brother said, "Do you realize that all children that were born afterwards were born in an era of redemption? And therefore, our souls, who were born in an era of exile, don't really understand these neshamas, because they come from a messianic era, from a Mashiach era. And we are teaching them exile-based Judaism, when really their souls are looking for a higher consciousness of Judaism, because they're post-redemption energy-like. So they're coming to us, and we're preaching to them. They're coming to us, and we're preaching to them an exile-based Judaism, which their souls—it's fine—which their souls reject because of their deep connection to a higher consciousness." And he says, "And most yeshivas can't really relate to these neshamas, to these souls, because these souls are rejecting the message that is not speaking to them, because they're looking for something much more real and much deeper." This was his insight to me. He was right. He was on target. He was on target. People often lament a new generation. They lament the youth. They talk about all the problems and challenges and all the problems and challenges. They often fail to realize, I told this to Menachem Mendel tonight on the way here. He graciously drove me, and I shared with him a metaphor. There was a scientist, Heisenberg, shared. He said that there was once a fisherman who took his net, and he lowered it into the ocean, and he lifted up the net after a few weeks, and he said he finally has discovered thousands of new species of fish through this net that he had in the ocean for weeks. And he wants to tell the world that there's no fish smaller than 7 inches. Of course, this was the laughing stock of everybody, because people have goldfish in their dining rooms, and goldfish are quite smaller than 7 inches. What was the problem? The problem was that the holes in the net, each hole was 7 inches wide. So therefore, it could not grasp fish smaller than 7 inches, which means that the instruments you use to determine reality will define the reality that you will determine through those instruments. But we often fail to examine the potency and relevance of those instruments. We just come to the conclusion that there's no fish smaller than 7 inches. So if you're using weak or poor instruments that are inadequate, your conclusions will naturally be extremely flawed. I maintain that in order to understand today's youth, you have to change your prescription. You have to put on you can't increase the prescription. You have to completely change your paradigm shift, because our net is wrong. And therefore, we're not catching the fish, because our net is simply completely wrong. We're dealing with young people who have a level of honesty that I haven't seen. I don't remember. There's no games. No, hypocrisy is not acceptable. All the symptoms of redemption, that you need raw truth complete truth, MS, complete truth, not even, like, it was acceptable when I was growing up for a teacher to preach what he didn't believe in. We all knew it. So what? Right? Today, it's almost, you're allergic to it. You go crazy from it. You'll reject the whole thing because this is not redemption. This is not wholesome. This is not the real thing. So therefore, when I want to feel young and I want to feel inspired and I want to feel a little more naked and a little more real, I come to be with you to be able to learn about life and to be able to steer life nakedly and squarely in the eyes, without blinking, without moving away, without turning around.
Without flinching.
Huh?
Without flinching.
Without flinching, without cute cliches or cover-ups. On an emotional level, I know that some of you have personally been through, you know, they say a cat has 9 lives. And some of you are like on your 19th life. You have seen loss. You have seen tragedy. You have seen death. You have seen insanity. You have seen abuse. You have seen pain. You have seen rejection. You have seen tears. But people who have seen all of this have a great advantage. And that is, when you laugh, you really laugh. And when you party, you really party. And when you celebrate, you really celebrate. And when you live, you actually live. Because many people, they're not really alive. They're just simply alive because they never had a chance to die. But most of you had a chance to die. So when you live, you actually choose to live. And when you breathe, you choose to breathe. And it's very exhilarating. That was the feeling when I walked into this room. That was my feeling here. So I want to thank you for the opportunity and the privilege of being with such messianic souls here this evening. Anybody who's before 1990 could get out of the room now. Just joking. Just joking. But that includes myself.
Can we do tshuva? Can we do tshuva?
It's hard. If you hang out around Aliya enough, maybe you can do tshuva.
Oh, good.
Maybe they'll accept you.